Welcome, welcome, welcome. I would like to welcome you to another episode of the Unpopular Podcast. This is the man, the myth, the legend, Jalen Hunter. And if you would do me a favor, please subscribe to whoever you're listening. Please subscribe to whoever you're watching. It definitely means a lot to me. Before I start, I want to apologize for not releasing an episode on Saturday. This weekend, man, this weekend was busy, man. Or last weekend was busy, man. The weapons that God formed against me, they were prospering a little bit. But we back, and I appreciate you guys. I appreciate the people that would reach out asking where the episode was. Look, I apologize. It was just a lot going on. But we're here. And since last Wednesday, there's a lot that's happened in the playoff world. Hell, we're in the conference finals now. Last night, of course, game one of the Eastern Conference Finals, which is Boston and Miami, took place. But the biggest story in the East is realization. Sometimes, you know, realization is tough for a lot of people. It's tough because a lot of times realization is something that a lot of people go against. Because realization, sometimes, a lot of times, realization takes you out of a bubble that you think that's just not realistic, or that's not reality. You have to realize something. Realize something usually means that you don't know something. It's like, oh, let's talk about it. So James Harden and the 76ers got bounced out the second round of the playoffs to Miami Heat. Now they lost 4-2. Joel Embiid missed the first two games due to, of course, the orbital fracture. But we had a clear sense of realization with James Harden. And the thing about this is, we've seen this multiple times. I just don't think that we've seen this to a level that we've seen it with him outside of this year. And what am I talking about? Who is James Harden? What is the aura of James Harden? James Harden is one of the most offensively gifted players we have ever seen. At his height, a lot of people were, including myself, I was in the boat, I'm not gonna lie to you, I was in the boat when I was comparing and I was questioning if James Harden is better than players like Dwayne Wade. I wouldn't go as far as say Kobe, but Dwayne Wade, I was staunch in that argument and saying, hey, James Harden might be better than Dwayne Wade. Now, that's no disrespect to Dwayne Wade, but that shows, and Dwayne Wade's a three-time champion, you know, all 70 or NBA 75, one of the greatest shooting guards to ever play. So that's no disrespect to Dwayne Wade. That's more of a respect to James Harden. He was putting up 60-point triple-doubles, 50-point triple-doubles. Just going crazy. MVP, finished runner-up a couple years. But here's the thing about James Harden. And we've seen this time and time again now. Now, it's hard to realize, well, it's hard to accept it. Of course, people talk about it, but it's hard to accept it. Because accepting the realization usually means that either you closed your eyes to something that was clearly there, or you lived in a fantasy world where you thought something was real, but it wasn't. Realization. James Harden, time and time and time and time and time again, has come up small in the playoffs. And honestly, I think this year was the worst. Now, there was, you know, when he was in Houston, they were in the playoffs against the Spurs. I don't think Kawhi Leonard played like the last two games or something, or last two or three games, and they lost him. We remember the famous, you know, James Harden goes up for a shot, Manu Ginobili comes behind him and blocks a shot. End of the series. We can go a little further. You're in the what? Western Conference Finals with Dwight Howard. No, we can even go. They won this, but you can. They're playing the Clippers. James Harden's playing majority of the game, and they are getting destroyed. You bench James Harden, you put in players like Josh Smith. I think Corey Brewer. And y'all come back and beat the Clippers with James Harden on the bench. Against Golden State. Now, of course, it's hard to imagine a team beating Golden State. I think Golden State had the greatest team of all time. Now, you can argue. You can leave it in the comments. It is what it is. I think the 2017-18 Golden State was the greatest team we've ever seen. Prime Steph Curry, prime Kevin Durant, prime Draymond Green, prime Klay Thompson, a veteran in Andre Iguodala. You had JaVale McGee, Zaza. I feel that was the greatest team we've ever seen. So it's hard to imagine a team beating that team. So I understand, you know, not beating them the first iteration. But then next year, you have one of the best. You have Chris Paul. You have PJ Tucker. You have Clint Capella. You have Trevor Ariza. And you're up 3-2 in the series. 3-2. Now, a lot of people are going to attribute that loss to Chris Paul not being there, which I understand. That is a huge thing. Chris Paul and his hamstring. Yeah. But James Harden is a superstar. James Harden is the same player that we have arguments. Is he better than Dwayne Wade? A lot of people were putting him in the Kobe Bryant class. A lot of people were saying he's a top five shooting guard ever. You still have that player. Yes, you're losing Chris Paul, but you still have James Harden. You lose two games in a row. One of which, of course, is at home. You're up 15, and then you go on and miss 27 straight threes. So you don't come up big in that game or that series either. Next year, you're playing Golden State again. It's hard. I mean, it's Golden State. It's our nemesis. Wait. You all, this year, you, Houston, has the healthier team. Chris Paul's healthy. James Harden's healthy. You're playing Golden State without Kevin Durant. You lose. You fold. Now, of course, you then do the move to Brooklyn. You can't really, you know, you can't predict injuries, clearly. But what you can say is you come into Brooklyn or you get traded from Houston to Brooklyn. You're, you know, Kyrie, KD, James Harden. You're supposed to be big. You hurt your hamstring. Come to the playoffs. You hurt yourself pretty much the first, minute. Then you try to come back game, four and five, or no, game six and seven are clearly hobbled. Understand. It's a hamstring. The hamstrings are very serious. I get that. But then you follow that up with coming into the season out of shape. Not to mention, I completely forgot the fact that you came into the season, the previous season, with Houston out of shape. Coming out of shape. And there's a thing that let me let me side note this. I don't remember who said this. Of course, it was an analyst that said it. But you don't play basketball to get into shape. You get into shape to play basketball. Especially when we talk about the NBA. So when you're starting to see, you know, nagging injuries or a player there, when you're looking at James Harden now, it's hard for me to look at James Harden now and not see and not think that coming into multiple years, I think like maybe three or four years now, a lot of people are saying you're seeing this James Harden because all he does is, you know, hang around Lil Baby, hang around, you know, that crew, hang around rappers, this, that, and third. I don't think that's the truth. I mean, he was doing that in Houston and putting up 60-point triple-doubles. What it is it's hard when every single year you have to play yourself into shape. That's one reason why I think Anthony Davis continues to get hurt. It's hard when you have to play yourself into shape. So that by the time you get halfway through the season, by the time you get to the end of the season, your body's worn down because it had to go into overdrive to try to get yourself into shape instead of staying in shape, or at least staying close to game shape for the offseason or during the offseason. So when you come into the preseason, when you come to the training camp, when you come to the beginning of the season, you're not pushing harder than anybody else because you're already there. But when your body has to constantly start from the ground up, when you come into the season, that puts a toll. So then you see, you know, nagging injury towards the end of the season. Do you realize most of James Harden's injuries come towards the end of the season? Why do you think that is? Now, no, this year wasn't an injury, but we'll talk about this year. But it's just tough, man. It's tough when you every year you play yourself into shape so that when you get to the playoffs, when they need you the most, you don't have it because your body is spent. Your body is worn down. Your body doesn't have it anymore because you had to kick it into overdrive when you should have just been, I'm not going to say coasting, but you should have just been revving it up. It's kind of like when you start a car in winter. Now, I'm not the best at this, so I'm not preaching to anybody, but it's kind of like when you start your car in winter. You know how they say you're supposed to start your car and let it sit and warm up? Like, you're not just supposed to, in the winter, you're not just supposed to start your car and dip. That's what James Harden was starting his car, which, of course, in this, you know, analogy is his body, and just going. No, you have to let it warm up. That's what the beginning of the regular, you know, the preseason, regular season, that's what it is. That's why you see a lot of bad basketball in the beginning of the season, because people, they're just revving up. So you get to this year for James Harden. In fact, let's not forget the huge point that he asked to be traded from Brooklyn. He wanted to go to Philly. He says Philly was his first choice in the first place. All right, I get it. Cool. You asked to go to Philly. Philly then trades Ben Simmons. Philly also trades Seth Curry and Andre Drummond. So now you're in Philly. What Philly was hoping that they were getting, what people were saying, there's a reason why when James Harden went to Philly, a lot of people were saying that they are NBA Finals bound. A lot of people were even saying that they were going to win the NBA Finals. Why is that? Because of what they thought they were getting, because of what they thought that we were going to see, because of what they thought James Harden was going to be. Let's not negate the fact. Let's just completely gloss over not only the last year of Houston, but the years in Brooklyn. Now, I'm not saying he was terrible in Brooklyn, but what I am saying is he was clearly not the James Harden that we're used to seeing in Brooklyn. Now, a lot of people attribute that to, well, this is the first time he was playing against or playing with bona fide superstars since he was with OKC. And of course, we're talking about Kevin Durant and Kyrie Irving. So a lot of people were saying, okay, that's probably why James Harden had to rein it back. I think now we're starting to see that that is not the case. The case is he just doesn't, I'm not going to say he doesn't have it anymore, because that would be disrespectful to James Harden. That'd be disrespectful to, you know, an NBA basketball player. But what I am saying is, a lot of people expected when you paired Joel Embiid, who this year was second consecutive year where he finished second in the MVP vote or MVP race. You pair Joel Embiid with James Harden. And a lot of people were saying that that could be the next lethal duo, like Shaq and Kobe. You know, when we talk about a guard and a big. So then you get to the playoffs, man. And I don't know what it is. I don't know what it was. This is why I think that this year was probably the worst flameout I've ever seen. Or let me say this. Let me not say that. This was the worst flameout from James Harden I've ever seen. Forget the fact that you played Golden State the second year you played, or 2018, I think. You played Golden State without Kevin Durant. You were the clearly better team against the Spurs without Kawhi Leonard. You lost. I'm not going to talk about the NBA Finals when, you know, it was OKC because he was still young. But the reason why this, to me, is the worst flameout that we've seen from James Harden. And it's funny that it's sad that we can do a montage of flameouts in the playoffs. And that's kind of the realization I was talking about. Is two realizations. There is a difference. We talk about Rondo, Rajon Rondo. How there is a clear-cut regular season Rondo and a playoff Rondo. We talk about that all the time. That's pretty much a running joke in the basketball community. But it's not really a running joke, but it's serious. Rondo plays better in the playoffs. Hell, I know it's crazy to think, seeing as how great he is. But there's a difference between regular season LeBron James and playoff LeBron James. LeBron James plays considerably better in the playoffs. The reason why this is the worst flameout that I think we've seen from James Harden is because he was so... The team depended on him so much. The team depended on him so much with Joel Embiid going out the first, two games. You don't bring James Harden to the 76ers for the regular season. No team makes a move for the regular season. Not a team. Not in the NBA. Not in the NFL. Not in the NHL. No team makes a decision for the regular season. Every team makes a decision for the playoffs. And they needed James Harden. And it's not only the fact that he wasn't. We're talking about the last game. We're talking about game six. Game six. James Harden in the second. I think he had 11 points in the first half. First half, he finished the game with 11 points and only took two shots in the second half, missed both, took two shots. That is why this is the worst flameout, because your team needs you. Joel Embiid struggling at this point. And the fact that the Miami Heat started doubling. Well, there was nothing you can do with Joel Embiid, so it's like, and Joel Embiid, like I said, was struggling with the, you know, his face, he kept going down. He hit the floor so many times in that series. But James Harden was not aggressive. when the team needed him to. It'd be different if he finished with 11 points. Yet he took 15 15 shots in the second half. To only take two and get blown off the floor is like I said, the narrative is set. It's not even a narrative at this point. It's proof. We've seen it. It's set. There is a difference between regular season James Harden. You know what? You see that? Just like that. Realization. I just have a realization. There was a difference between playoff James Harden, regular season James Harden. There was a difference. Now, because now I'm starting to put it all together. I'm starting to put together what happened in Brooklyn. I'm starting to put together what happened in Philly. Now there's no difference. I don't know. I'm not a doctor, but I truly think the reason why a lot of people say James Harden doesn't have it anymore is because his body, doesn't have it anymore. But that's on him. See, you can't predict injuries. And I'm not wishing an injury upon anybody. You can't predict injuries. But what you can do is predict the trajectory of a season. And like I said, I'm going full circle, I guess you can say. When James Harden comes into a season out of shape, watch how it ends. And again, knock on wood, I'm not wishing injury upon anybody. But watch how a James Harden season, when reports or you can see he comes in out of shape, watch how it ends. It's either going to end with him being injured, which I don't hope injury upon anybody, or a flame out like we saw this year, because the body just doesn't have it. And I think the worst part about this year was it wasn't just the body. It was the mind that he tuned out. Game six. Your team needs you, because Joel Embiid clearly just doesn't have it due to injury. Your team needs you. His body and his mind flamed out. So now the question is, now you heard that's pretty much been the talk since the series ended. Do you give James Harden a super max contract, which he is eligible for? And the reason why Philly is in such a tough spot is because what they gave up to get James Harden, and not only that, what they gave up to get James Harden and what they thought they were getting in James Harden. Because of course he you can buy into the player option, which I think he's going to probably, which is I think $48 million or something. But it's hard for me to see what I've seen from James Harden. And again, no team makes a trade. No team makes a big swing like this in the trade deadline for agency. No team makes a huge swing like getting James Harden and trading a player in Ben Simmons that has 3 years left in his contract. Nobody makes those moves for a regular season move. But it's hard for me to want to give up or to justify giving a player the max the super max when I've seen multiple flameouts in the most important times. What is James Harden's signature moment? What is James Harden's signature moment? I have one. Let me say this. I have about 10 signature moments from James Harden. I can name 5 signature moments from James Harden. The problem is none of them are in the playoffs. You can talk about the crossover with Wesley Matthews. Wesley Johnson. The crossover with Wesley Johnson, where he looked down at this man, licked his lips, and boom. The game where I think he became the all-time leader in points scored in Houston, which I think was ironically the game where he had a 60-point or 59-point triple-double or something like that. You could talk about this first game in Houston when you didn't know, you know, he just got traded from OKC. You don't know exactly what we're getting from James Harden. I think he comes out and scores like 39. James Harden has a lot of signature moments. Good signature moments, because I'm not going to, well, he has a lot of bad ones. No, good signature moments. None of them are in the playoffs. And that's why Philly got him. So I'm always for the player to get their money. I am always for the player. But it's just hard for me to see how James Harden's season has ended the last few years and think that guy deserves a Supermax, especially this year. Especially this year. He only took 2 shots when Joel Embiid didn't have it. He was on the floor. He was tired. And don't get me wrong. I'm not blaming the whole Sixers not making it could do on James Harden. I mean, I think the team was constructed wrong. You know, Tyrese Maxey was great, but they didn't really, their best shooter, their best 3-point shooter was Danny Green. He went out, and I'm not saying if Danny Green was there, it would have been different. No, prayers up for Danny Green. He tore his ACL and LCL. So with his age, I don't know if we've seen the last of Danny Green in the NBA, but I do hope for a speedy recovery. But Tobias Harris, he is inconsistent, you know. So I'm not blaming the whole, you know, failed season, in my opinion, on James Harden. What I am doing is highlighting the fact that he was a big piece to the loss at the end. Because of his lack of aggression, because of his body not having the energy, not having the speed to get around people, him thinking it's acceptable to take 2 shots in the second half of an entire game, a game 6, by the way. Yeah. I'm never for someone not getting their money. Don't get me wrong. But it's hard. It would be hard for me as an organization to see our second most important player, top 75 or NBA 75 player, will go down as one of the greatest offensive weapons the league has ever, one of the greatest they've ever seen. Look at that man and think to myself, he deserves a Supermax, when I've seen multiple flameouts and of different varieties. So that's just that, man. Let's move on. One. There's only been one that I can think of. Jay, what are you talking about? One. It's been said that a team that is led by a small guard cannot win a championship. So I thought, I was like, man, that can't be true. There's been some great, great point guards that are of the smaller mindset. I really got to thinking. One. There has only been one that I can think of. Now, if I'm wrong, leave it in the comments. We'll talk about it. But there's only one team that I can think of that was led by a small point guard that won a championship. And that was the Detroit Pistons and Isaiah Thomas. Now, that Detroit Pistons team also had Bill Laimbeer. It had some Joe Dumars. It had some incredible players. Some Hall of Fame players. But there's only been one. Now, there has been some great smaller guards in the league. Hell, my favorite player of all time, Allen Iverson, led a team to the finals. They just didn't win. Isaiah Thomas, the one, you know, that played for the recent one, the one that played for Boston. We'll talk about Kyrie. That's actually, people are going to say, but what about Kyrie? Yo, first of all, Kyrie didn't lead that team. It was LeBron James. And also, it was LeBron James. Damian Lillard, I mean, we see him struggle to even make it out the first round year after year. Only one team has ever been led, or only one team that's been led by a small guard has ever won a championship. And that is Isaiah Thomas and the Detroit Pistons. Now, when I say led, I mean that guard is their best player. Like, it was clear Allen Iverson was the best player on the 76ers teams. It was clear that Damian Lillard is the best player on Portland. Now, people can say, but what about Steph Curry? 2015. Yeah, he's 6'3". So, he's the greatest shooter of all time. So, but I say all that to say, Chris Paul and the Suns got they ass whooped against Luka and the Dallas Mavericks, which ultimately saw the Mavericks advance to the Western Conference Finals, where the best team in the regular season, by a long shot, in the Phoenix Suns, get bounced out the second round. A lot of people say that Chris Paul is cursed. A lot of people. You know, whether it's injury at the worst moments, i.e. Houston, or his team just royally flames out. Or his team just royally just doesn't get it done. I mean, I think Chris Paul, I think they said he's lost 5 straight series when he's been up 2 games to none. But I don't think it's cursed. I think it like this. If Chris Paul is your best player, first of all, side note, let me kind of discuss Patrick Beverley for a second. Patrick Beverley went on ESPN. He's been on the ESPN run, and he was going crazy with Chris Paul. Just saying some wild things. I do think a lot of it was disrespectful. I really do. Especially, you don't need to divulge personal conversations. You don't need to. You can feel how you feel, but there's a way of presenting how you feel, and you don't need to berate or defame someone's name for if they did. Now, I understand that there's a beef between Patrick Beverley and Chris Paul. I get that, but there's a difference between being professionalism or being professional and just venting and just going crazy on. And I think Patrick Beverley has been mad disrespectful to Chris Paul. I hate the argument that people say, well, what have you done in this league to say something? If you feel like I can speak on how I feel about something, you know, I can speak on how I feel about don't know. Hell, I speak on what I think about sports. I mean, this is a sports podcast, and I've never played in the NBA. I've never played in the NFL. I've never played in the MLB. I've never played in the NHL. I've never played professional sports. But this is my platform. And I think that even with this being my platform, there's a difference between being classy and saying how you feel or being controversial and just being messy. And I think that Patrick Beverly was just disrespectful. But let's get back to Chris Paul. I don't think that he's cursed. And this whole basketball gods has already deemed that Chris Paul would never win a championship. What I think it is you're seeing realization. Yet another realization. We are realizing something. Look at every single time. Every single time. Chris Paul has lost in the playoffs outside of injury. The winning team has done the same thing every single time. Hunted Chris Paul because he is short. And shorter guards, especially a guard like Chris Paul, shorter guards and as old as Chris Paul is, the juices get zapped from their legs quicker than a younger guard. Now, trust me, we will get to Devin Booker in a second, but the juices, like, it's just the energy gets zapped out of you quicker, and it's harder to recover. So if you look at this year, yo, they were running a clinic on whoever Chris Paul was guarding. They would find a way to get Luka Doncic, 6'7", by the way, 6'7", 24-year-old Luka Doncic. They would get him switched on Chris Paul religiously. Spencer Dinwiddie was who I think is 6'4", 6'5", was getting switched on to Chris Paul. Yo, Jalen Brunson, who was of shorter stature, was backing down Chris Paul. That happens time and time and time again with Chris Paul. Because a small guard, the reason why I think that we've seen that a small guard cannot lead a team to a championship is because there is a game plan on how to beat a small guard or a team that is led by a small guard. There's a game plan. And if you complete that game plan to a T, you're going to win. And that is hunt that guard on every offensive trip you have. So that by the fourth quarter, he's tired. Now, there's also a reason if you look at, now I think it was a thumb one time, but if you look, a lot of Chris Paul's injuries are lower extremities, hamstring, quad injuries. Why is that? Because by the end of the game, by the end of the series, he is tired. And now he's 37. 37 trying to guard a 6'7 Luka Doncic. And I know I was one of those people that said last year was, if they're not going to win a championship last year, seeing as though that was the first year that Chris Paul made it to the NBA Finals. They were up 2-0 against Milwaukee. Ended up losing 4-2 or 4 straight. So I was one of those people that if he don't win this year, it's not going to happen. Then I changed my tune really quickly in the regular season because they were just mopping people. I put my blinders on because I'm like, I mean, the team, you're going in. I think they won like 64 games. You're going in playoffs. You're the hottest team. Chris Paul did get hurt, but, you know, came relatively healthy. Put the blinders on, not realizing that a Chris Paul-led team loses the same way every year. And I was wrong yet again, and I will be on this boat now. I think that this was their best option, and I'm going to tell you why. Now, let's go over to Devin Booker. There's a reason why when we talk about the best guards, when we talk about, you know, top, I don't know, five best shooting guards, why a lot of people usually leave out Devin Booker. A lot of people leave out Devin Booker because Devin Booker is so one-sided. And when I say one-sided, I mean he's such an offensive talent. But that's about it. He's not good defensively. He's, when I say offensive talent, I mean scoring the ball, but he's not really good. He doesn't really elevate a team. He doesn't elevate anybody else because he is, and that's no disrespect to Devin Booker. That is what he is. Devin Booker is an offensive weapon, but that's about it. And as we saw, if his shot's not falling, that's it. Devin, you can neutralize Devin Booker. Because Devin Booker is not going to make the right pass. I'm not going to say. He's going to be reluctant to make the right pass. He's going to be reluctant to pass the ball anyways because he is always score first. That's the reason why Devin Booker was, I think, the leading scorer in the first quarter in the entire season. Because he looks to score. And in the biggest moments against Phoenix, not Phoenix, against Dallas, they were like, "Ayo, we're going to do the same thing to Chris Paul that we're going to do to you. Hunt him." Because what Devin Booker was then trying to do was hunting for calls. You know, that's what he started to do. And once you start hunting for calls, your brain go straight like on possessions, especially possessions when you've already usually here's a fun fact. Now I know I've never played in the NBA, but I have played college ball. And I'ma tell you, when you touch the ball, now basketball is very reactionary, but if you're an offensive player, usually when you touch the ball, you know what you're going, you know what you want to do. Now, the defense then sometimes dictate that, but a lot of times you know what you want to do. So by the time a person passes you the ball, you either know that by the time it hits your hand, you know that you either want to A, drive, or B, shoot. Devin Booker starts, all right, I'm going to try to get this foul. Luka or whoever's playing close to me, Reggie Bullock is playing close to me. I'm going to try to get this foul. And you look for the foul more than you concentrate on the shot. So that's why you look like, damn, Devin Booker was 3-for-14 because he was hunting for calls, not hunting for makes. And Devin Booker is an incredible player. But if you do not have a two-way player, if you don't have a player, let me say this, if you don't have, Devin Booker can't be the leader of a team, which is why they relied so heavily on a 37 now year old Chris Paul. Why do you think Chris Paul and the Houston, Chris Paul, James Harden, the Houston Rockets were this close of beating Golden State in 2017? This close. Because Chris Paul was not the number one. The number one was James Harden. Now, ultimately, they didn't win, and we just discussed that. But Chris Paul, he didn't have to worry about, like, he didn't have to worry about taking command of the team. Now, that is also what kind of did Houston in, seeing as though there was a tug-of-war match between whose team it was with James Harden and Chris Paul, this, that, and the third. But they almost beat Golden State, the team that I just said was the greatest team of all time. You can't have a team in the Suns where your best player can get hunted easily on defense. And is a huge... Now, yes, I understand he's an all... He's been in all defensive teams. Chris Paul, I understand. Chris, and that's no disrespect. Look, Chris Paul is a top five point guard ever, in my opinion. Chris Paul will go down as, I think a lot of people, of course, talk about accolades. I get it. But I do think, let me just leave it at that. I think Chris Paul is a top five point guard of all time. I think he is one of the greatest players we've ever seen. But that doesn't negate the fact that he is easily targetable in a playoff series. Now, yes, offensively, he's going to get his. We know his spot. Offensively, he's going to get his. But even this year, game three, his offense just fell off a cliff because they started hunting him and he just didn't have his legs. So I say all that to say, you can't have a team where Chris Paul is your number one. Your number two in Devin Booker is an incredible talent, but doesn't do anything. Well, is an incredible scoring talent, but doesn't do anything else. And your third option is DeAndre Ayton, who, by the way, probably won't be there because he doesn't feel respected by the organization, which is, I think, one of the biggest reasons why he only played 17 minutes in the final game. Now, yes, they lost by damn near 50, but there's a reason why I don't even think DeAndre Ayton is going to be there. So unless they make a huge swing at a free agent or a huge swing at a trade and get a star player. Now, I don't know who they could get, but get a star player. Because there's a lot of players that have player options. There's a lot of players that have, that's going to be free agents. So we could see, but if they don't, they're going to be in the same boat next year. They're going to be incredible in the regular season. But that's about it. So let's move forward. And then we get to Giannis and the Bucks. There's not really much to dissect when we talk about the Bucks losing. Exactly what we watching that Bucks Boston series really showed you why Chris Middleton is so important. Now, a lot of people want to throw dirt on Chris Middleton. A lot of people want to say that it's Giannis and a bunch of nobodies, but Chris Middleton is most important to the Bucks in the half court. As we saw, Giannis is still Giannis. I think he became the first player ever to have 200 plus points, 100 plus rebounds, and like 50 plus assists in one series. There's some players that don't do that in a season. He did that in a series. And they still lost. You usually see it. Now, you didn't see it with the Suns and Dallas, but I tweeted this. You usually see this. The best team is going to beat the best player every time if the best player doesn't have a solid team. And don't get me wrong, I'm not saying the Bucks are not a solid team. I mean, they just won an NBA championship last year. But the Bucks team, this even happened last year. They struggle in half-court offense. Giannis is still Giannis, but outside of that, Jrue Holiday is still a great player, so underrated, but he's not the most offensively gifted. Grayson Allen, I don't know what the hell he was doing. Pat Connaughton, he'll hit big shots. Brook Lopez, he's still a big. He can stretch, but he's on and off. Bobby Porter, same way. The most consistent, two consistent players that the Milwaukee Bucks have, when we talk about all, when we talk about half court offense, is Chris Middleton and Giannis, and one of them were gone. I don't think this hurts, you know. Like, Giannis still did his thing. And this is just this is pretty much, that's why when you looked at game seven, Giannis was missing chippies. Like, he was missing layup. Like, his long arms was right at the rim and missing layups. He just didn't have his legs. He was tired. When you get bodies thrown at you left and right by arguably best team in the league at this point, you need that second option. And while Jrue Holiday wasn't, at least offensively, wasn't as consistent as it needed him to be because he's not Chris Middleton. So I think the Bucks will be back next year. I don't know. Chris, it just shows you how important Chris Middleton is. That's what that shows you. That's what it shows you. And shouts out to Boston, but that's what it shows. Giannis was putting up. Giannis was showing the world. Giannis lost. Giannis lost. And everyone in the world reminded everyone in a loss. He struggled. In a loss, he reminded everyone that, yeah. In a loss, people went out that loss thinking to themselves, yeah, well, Giannis is the best player in the world. Like, Giannis loses, and that's what they say. Like, it wasn't, oh, yeah, this is on Giannis. No, they, well, Giannis is the best player in the world. That's what happened. It was 2015, NBA Finals. You had LeBron James and the Cleveland Cavaliers. You had Steph Curry and the Golden State Warriors. Both Kyrie and Kevin Love went out. LeBron was putting up epic numbers, and you thought to yourself, even though they did lose the series, you thought to yourself, yeah, LeBron James, he's the best player in the world. Same thing you saw 2017. No, 18. 2018. No, 2017. 2017, the Cleveland Cavaliers lost 4-1 in the finals. LeBron James had like a 50-pointer the first game. That's the one where J.R. Smith just forgot what time it was or whatever. And you still thought to yourself, yeah, LeBron James, he did just lose 4-1. He's still the best player in the world. That's what we said about Giannis this series. We looked at Giannis. He lost, but he was just like, hey. And he struggled the last game. But he was like, hey, Giannis is the best player. I don't know what to tell you. I don't know what to tell you. They need Chris Middleton. So now we're in the conference finals. My predictions, you have Golden State going against Dallas. One, I didn't expect that. I thought it was going to be Golden State and Phoenix, just like a lot of people. But shouts out you now. Dallas has a good shot of winning. You have the best player at least at this point. If we look at the totality of this season, you have the most consistent, the best player in Luka. Luka, I think he averages the most points in a game seven. I think he averaged like 39 points. I think he's averaging like 33 this playoffs. Like, he's been going crazy. And if I'm Golden State, I don't think you just throw bodies at him. Just keep throwing bodies at him. But there's no way I'm looking at what we've seen and thinking, yo, we can stop Luka. We're not stopping Luka. What it is Luka is not going to outscore the team. So you just make sure Jalen Brunson, you make sure Spencer Dinwiddie, you make sure Dorian Finney-Smith, you make sure Max Kleber, you make sure nobody else goes off. Because that's what happened towards the end of the Phoenix series. Jalen Brunson started going off, and Spencer Dinwiddie had 30 points at the end of game six. Luka can go off. You just can't let nobody else do that. And Luka's going to get his numbers. Luka's going to have some 40-point games. He damn near might have a 50-point game. Like, Luka's going to have his. It's just if Golden State, one, limits their turnovers, and two, is able to slow down everyone else, I think that that's going to happen. I don't know about the turnovers because they've struggled with turnovers. Lord Jesus, they struggle with turnovers. But you get Steve Kerr back. I think that, you know, Klay Thompson hopefully gets out of his slump, even though he looked great in game six against Memphis. Steph Curry kind of gets out of his slump. I think that's the biggest reason why I have Golden State winning this series is because I think that they know we're not stopping Luka. We can try to slow him down, but we're not stopping Luka. It's just stop everyone else. And I think they have the – I don't think that – even though Dallas is a really good defensive team, I don't think when everyone – because Jordan Poole has been struggling too. But I think he was struggling due to the physicality that Memphis – holds, you know, when you have Desmond Bain hitting like freaking muscle bound soldier just hitting you in every play, it's just nah. But I just think that Golden State has the ability to slow everyone else down while scoring better than Dallas as a team. So I have Golden State winning this series. I'll say in six games. And in the Eastern Conference, man, for one, shouts out to the Miami Heat, man. They have been incredible all season. They're probably one of the most disrespected number ones we've seen because nobody talks about them. And even as a number one, I don't think – look, I have Boston winning this series because I think Miami is a better – I think both teams are incredible defensively. I mean, Boston has arguably been the best defensive team since January. In Miami, I mean, we've seen the dismantling that they do with their guard, like they did with Trae Young, that they did with James Harden. But when we talk about offensively, I think Boston, I mean, we just saw Boston hit like 27 threes, I think. I just don't think that they can keep up offensively with Boston. And I think the defenses are going to equal each other out. I just don't think offensively. Miami can keep up with Boston, especially when you have Jason Tatum going crazy. He had a 46-point game in Milwaukee. Like Jaylen Brown, Grant Williams. Now I don't know. It was wild to me that Milwaukee let. Let Grant Williams wide open the entire game. I don't get that, but it is what it is. So right now I have a Boston and Golden State finals. So we'll see how it goes. Shouts out to all the teams, and let me know how you think. Let me know how you think the Eastern Conference Finals is going to go. Let me know how you think the Western Conference Finals is going to go. So moving forward, so we are in the middle of the NHL playoffs, and unfortunately, my Capitals didn't make it. My Capitals lost to Florida. Now, granted, the Capitals was a wild card team. Florida was the number one team in the Metropolitan. You know, we had some injuries. I say we like I play for the, but yeah, my Capitals didn't make it. But right now, I mean, you have Colorado, you have St. Louis, you have the Oilers, you have the Flames, you have the Rangers, the Hurricane, or yeah, the Hurricanes. You have the team looking to three-peat in the Lightning, and of course the Florida Panthers. Well, damn, my Capitals are out. So I'm gonna go with, man, look, I'm gonna go with the Hurricanes. No, because they did struggle against, they had to go to a game seven against Boston. Freak it, man. I'm gonna go with the Florida Panthers, which is big because they're going up against now the Lightning that literally is going for a three-peat. But I'm going with my that's tough though, because the Oilers did struggle against the Kings, but the Oilers, in my opinion, have the best player remaining in the playoffs in Connor McDavid. And the Oilers is a really good team. And that's Connor McDavid. Nope. I'm going to say the Florida Panthers. We will reconvene after the next round, but I will say the Florida Panthers are going to win it all. So, yeah. Damn, shouts out to... It's unfortunate for my Capitals, man. And before we go, unpopular topic of the week. Now, the NBA unveiled the Eastern Conference Finals MVP and Western Conference Finals MVP trophy. This is a new trophy that they will be handing out. Of course, the player that they think is the MVP of the Eastern Conference Finals, as well as the MVP of the Western Conference Finals. They also did some retooling to the Conference Final trophies and the Larry O'Brien trophy. And I will give my credit to baseball. Now, I am I'm a very loud speaker when we talk about my displeasure for a lot of things that baseball does. So I will give them credit where credit is due. One thing that I like is how they have an NL MVP and an AL MVP. Of course, NL is the National League, AL is the American League. I think the NBA should adopt that. I know we like a lot of things singular. I know we like a lot of things as far as one person, one thing. Like, there is one MVP. There is one comeback player of the year. There is one coach of the year. There is one defensive player of the year. I understand that. I understand that's what we're used to. Hell, same as football. There's, you know. But why? I don't understand how we make such a point to highlight the Eastern Conference and the Western Conference. We make it such a point that in the All-Star game, you have the East. Well, you used to have the East versus West. An Eastern, there can't be, shouts out to the WNBA, there can't be two Eastern Conference teams playing in the finals. There can't be two Western Conference teams playing in the finals. You make it such a point to highlight the Eastern Conference and the Western Conference. Yet and still, there's one MVP. I think they should go to the Eastern Conference MVP of the season, and the Western Conference, like this year. Let's look at this year. This year, Joel Embiid would have been the Eastern Conference MVP. Nikola Jokic would have been the Western Conference MVP. In my opinion, Tyler Herro would have been the Eastern Conference Sixth Man of the Year. I don't know. Who's a good six? I don't know. Let me just throw out a name. Cameron Johnson would have been Western Conference Sixth Man of the Year. I just think that they make it such a point to highlight that there's two conferences. They make it such a point to say East versus West, East versus West. Yet and still, there's one MVP. This is unpopular topic, whatever. But I just think, again, you make it give just like then there's an AL MVP, AL or NL MVP. There's an AL Comeback Player of the Year, NL Comeback Player of the Year. Like, make it for the NBA an Eastern Conference player comeback player of the year, a Western Conference comeback player of the year. You know what I mean? Like, just don't keep highlighting the fact that there's an Eastern Conference and a Western Conference, yet and still, when the biggest awards are here, you don't highlight the fact that there's an Eastern Conference and a Western Conference. It doesn't make sense to me. The only award that highlights that now is the Eastern Conference Finals MVP, the Western Conference Finals MVP, and of course, whatever team wins the Eastern Conference and the Western Conference, they get a trophy. But it's just like, Why does it take the Western Conference Finals and East, which I like, don't get me wrong. I like the fact that there's the Eastern Conference Finals MVP and the Western Conference Finals MVP. I like it because it shows the fact that there is two different conferences. And the NBA tries very hard and to show, hey, there's two different conferences here, yet and still, there's one MVP. That's all I'm saying, man. And there you have it. That's been today's episode of the Unpopular Podcast. I appreciate you guys. If you want an Unpopular Podcast shirt, hoodie, long sleeve, sweater, joggers, link in the description below. It's getting hot out there, y'all. It is getting hot. So go get your Unpopular. It feels good in the wind. Go get your Unpopular merch today. Go get your t-shirts today. The link is in the description below. I got you. Also, please subscribe to whoever you're listening. Please subscribe to whoever you're watching. Comment, leave a like. I'm trying to get them algorithms going. I'm trying to get more people to experience the Unpopular Podcast. I'm trying to get more subscribers on the YouTube. I'm trying to get more subscribers on the DSPs. And I can't do it without your help. So I appreciate you guys. And until next time, what was that? Much love.